Welcome to AP European History with Dr. Brovkin. We today begin a very, very complex topic, a huge one, that the difficulty is to put it all together in a short summary, and that's called La Belle Epoque. La Belle Epoque stands for a period roughly at the end of the 19th century, early 20, 30 years of the 20th century, sort of from 1860s and 70s to 1920s, including 1920s. 1930s is already a different period. It's all kind of very nebulous and not exact, but what really unites this topic, this Belle Epoque, is the period preceding World War One and immediately following World War One, which is a kind of a centerpiece, that is a kind of a breaking point in European history and in the world of ideas and art. Most importantly, some of the trends that were before World War One continued, and this is one, it's one single period. Now, it is so complex, it is so rich, that it truly exceeds that of Renaissance. If one were to define the period of the greatest artistic, philosophical, literature, art, architecture period in European history, the best, the richest, that would be this one. So this is why it's incredibly difficult to analyze it and discuss it, because once you focus on it, you can have books and books written, or hours and hours of lectures about any one of those specific ones. You could talk for hours about Impressionism and Post-Impressionism and the new architecture and the Art Moderne in architecture and in Futurism in poetry and in new trends in literature and in breakthroughs in psychology and in philosophy and in sociology. So that is the difficulty. Every one of those fields, and I'm not even talking about science and technology, this was, of course, even a bigger breakthrough. Every one of those fields, there were absolutely incredible breakthroughs and new beginnings that would be difficult to put it all together. That is the difficulty, to how do you present to students all these incredible achievements and breakthroughs and ideas and personalities in just 15, 20 minutes. It's virtually impossible. But I'll try to at least give you a glimpse of how rich this period was. So, as I said before, the most important thing about La Belle Epoque is that it touched everything, from science and technology to architecture, poetry, theater, literature, philosophy, music, science, medicine, psychology, sociology. And I will mention every one of those fields and at least one or two of their major representatives. If one were to identify what is it all about, how do they all connect? Again, a very difficult task. But I would say probably one could say this is the age of rebellion against reason. Now, if 18th century is the age of reason, the 19th century is the age of realism, realpolitik, and realism in arts and literature. The end of the 19th century and La Belle Epoque is probably what goes with it very well, is irrationality, celebration of irrationality, and a kind of a searching for the proof that the rational world doesn't exist, that rationality is nothing, irrationality, passion, unpredictability, rebellion is everything. So this is probably the unifying theme. If we look at the arts and paintings and architecture and philosophy, and even psychology, Freud, it's the celebration, or maybe not even celebration, but discovery and study of irrationality. Okay, well, let's start with the first steps, and that would be the new trends in philosophy. One is called positivism, and that's not a rebellion. This is the opposite. This is a celebration of life, as it is a celebration of realism, and that's associated with the name Auguste Comte, who is the author of positivism. Positivism basically suggests that life is getting better all the time. This is a kind of a motto of the English in the end of the 19th century, the celebration meaning that there's new things all the time and life is getting better all the time. Better in the sense there's more of everything. There is more GDP, there is growth in cities, growth in wealth, growth in production, growth in technology, growth of knowledge, growth of just about anything that's growing and getting better. And that is positivism. So this is kind of the starting point that you do have a new world that is coming up. You have cities that count in millions. You have huge cities, London, Paris, Berlin, Vienna, St. Petersburg. And these cities are unlike anything else because they have traffic, they have trams and cars and electricity and all kinds of things that have never been seen before. So this is kind of like positivism. However, very quickly from positivism, it goes into not the celebration so much as a quest into what it really means. And there you run into new interpretations. Well, for example, this is the time, if we stay with the English culture, this is a celebration. This is probably the best period in English literature, was James Joyce and Oscar Wilde and others. This is probably the period of the flourishing of English literature that not only is celebrating life, but on the contrary is looking into the vicissitudes of a human soul, the hidden passions inside a human being. And that's Oscar Wilde. James Joyce is known for that kind of analysis of human passions and feelings that sort of crowns the English literature of the 19th century. That is also has a parallel, very much so, with French literature and Russian literature, with Emile Zola, who is known for this kind of a graphic depiction of realism that is to a point of unacceptable by the Victorian society, which basically you show life as it is, but it's nasty, cruel, and dirty, especially his novels about the working class life, Germinal and others. So it's a kind of a transition. Talk about literature, it's a transition from realism in the middle of the 19th century to a kind of analysis of passions that break it into pieces. Well, in Russian literature, the best example would be the realism of Tolstoy in his novel War and Peace, which is like steady depiction of war and life and marriage and breakup and all kinds of and a steady progression of life. And then you have a transition to Dostoevsky, which is more like an explosion of passions in his novels, but also posing these philosophical questions that would bring us to Nietzsche and the German philosophy. And one of the questions that Dostoevsky posed in his very famous novel, Crime and Punishment, is what is permissible? Is it okay to kill a useless lady and to show by that she's useless and you are a superhero? Is it allowed to kill for your passion or for your beliefs or for what you believe is right? And these are the questions that he raises in the Crime and Punishment. And these themes are continued in his other novels, which earned him a reputation that he understands and shows the great Russian soul. Russian literature is the anatomy of Russian soul, which means the passions that drive people to do crazy things, both in love and in relationship, in friendship, and in politics as well. And then in his other novel called Biesy, or The Wild Ones, he analyzes the political implications of these wild souls that are really ready to do revolution, to subjugate other men, to establish dictatorship, to kill as many as necessary for realization of their passions. And many people say that he's in that novel, he was prophetic about showing the crazy bunch taking power in Russia, the Bolsheviks, and then turning it upside down. But going a bridge from Dostoevsky to Nietzsche, Nietzsche, in a sense, is talking about the same things as Dostoevsky, and that is what is permissible. And he's very, very explicit in his philosophy. Everything is permissible for the superhuman mensch, which is for the superhuman heroes, because men are driven by will to power, says Nietzsche. Will to power. That will to power among the superhero is everything is permissible, and then Nietzsche is blatantly declares God is dead. In other words, the restriction. Why God is dead? Because God is the restrictions of morality, Christian morality. You can't do this, you can't do this, this is against God, this is against societal rules. No, he says God is dead in a sense that everything is permissible now. Why? Because we are human beings, and among us there are the natural leaders, the superhero who can lead us to whatever. Now that goes very well with Bolshevik ideology and with what Dostoevsky was afraid about. So these are the kinds of themes in philosophy which actually analyze human being in new ways. Both, what is the connection between James Joyce and between Nietzsche? Well, obviously, at first sight, none. But if you look about the analysis of passions and the drive that it creates, it links up very well with Nietzsche and Dostoevsky, and also with Sigmund Freud, who studies human passions in a scientific way. And he's talking about the libido, and he's talking about the drive that explains irrationality. And that is, again, one of the major themes. That also links up with another philosopher, Henri Bergson, a French one, who is talking about the will to power, but actually the energy of the people, and applies it to a nation. And he's the author of the expression élan vital, which is the kind of a vital energy of a nation. So it's not just the conversation is about a person, an individual, but it's a kind of an application of these ideas to a nation, that a nation could have this élan that would rise it to great things. And in a sense, you could say, yes, the end of the 19th century is élan vital in European culture, because there were absolutely incredible breakthroughs in all of the fields that I've mentioned before. If we go to culture, thank you.